Yeah, there are so many moonshots here. I think the trouble we have is figuring out, ranking them. Mine is really rather mundane. I'm focused on healthcare. So in the US, healthcare is a huge problem. $3 trillion spent, over $3 trillion annually. 130 million people have at least one chronic disease, and it's only going to go up. I think in the next 20 years, it'll be 175 million people will have at least one chronic disease. Staggering. So my focus of today's talk is on central nervous system disorders, which afflicts almost half of those chronic disease patients, 60 million in the US, and 1.5 billion worldwide. You can imagine a population of India and US combined have central nervous system disorders. My focus of today's talk is really excluding psychiatric disorders, and you'll understand why, because the therapies I'm proposing here are not suitable for them. We spend $600-700 billion a year on it. One of the most debilitating of these is Alzheimer's, and it is growing at an alarming rate. Worldwide, I read somewhere that it's projected to double every 20 years. I don't know what we'll do with all these people and how we'll take care of them. Parkinson's, 1 million people in the US, 500,000 with multiple sclerosis. And these are really life-changing diseases. 20 million Americans with depression. Now, depression has reasonably good therapies for about 70% of them, but 30% of these patients are refractory to drug therapy. So the reason I'm talking about this today is that many of these diseases are poorly treated, or in some cases have no therapy, no viable therapy. And that is because the drugs that we do have serious side effects, which limits their efficacy, which limits their use. And CNS drugs, by the way, have the highest failure rate in late-stage clinical trials, and also because of nasty side effects. So the problem we're trying to address here is how do we take existing drugs, because drug discovery and getting through the FDA that's another issue, but drug discovery is a big challenge, and finding drugs and discovering and developing drugs that don't have the peripheral side effects is a very long-term endeavor. So if we look at the range of molecules that we have today approved, how can we use them while reducing serious side effects? And also solve for the new therapies, which are protein peptide-based, that cannot be delivered systemically, or orally, or by injection. And finally, for many of these diseases, such as Alzheimer's, patient compliance is a huge problem. So the question that we are asking is, how can we leverage existing drugs and also create a platform for new drugs to be delivered effectively, which reduce side effects and improve outcomes? So the solution, if you just think about it for 5 minutes, is it's rather obvious, which is don't give these drugs systemically. Give them intracranially where they're needed, so that you have therapeutic concentrations in the brain, but you don't have peripheral side effects, so dramatically reduce them. And if you can create a platform like that, if you had a platform like that, you could also deliver large molecules that don't go past the blood-brain barrier, and it also addresses patient compliance. So it's an old idea. It's not a new idea, and there are pumps available on the market. Medtronic has one, and a couple other folks. But all these pumps, when you think of pumping drugs, you think of a reservoir that has the drug and a pump mechanism that works under electronic control, and that's how these pumps work. The problem is the drug reservoir only can have, you know, maybe 10, 20 cc's of drug, which has to be refilled every couple of months. But if you can imagine a catheter going into the brain, having this device, and a physician going in every couple of months in refilling the thing, huge problem for in terms of the potential for introducing pathogens. Also, liquid drugs have reduced shelf life. So even if you made the drug reservoir really large to reduce the frequency of refills, you couldn't implant it. So these devices are already too big. And the cost of patient management, I read somewhere, are almost $40,000 or $50,000 a year for these patients who have intrathecal pumps for pain management because of frequent refills. By the way, a few of these patients died because in trying to refill the reservoir, the physician missed the septum and injected a big bolus of fentanyl into the patient, sort of on the spot. Big problem. So when I started looking at these things, I said, how do we do that? We have to solve for shelf life, drug shelf life, and pack enough drug in a device so as to eliminate refills. So I said, you know, what's the highest concentration of drug? It's in the pure drug substance. And if you can pelletize it into unit dose or subunit dose, you solve all the issues at once, long shelf life, and can be formulated for slow or fast release. And then each pellet is hermetically sealed. And that's a challenging process. And we have developed an implantable device that has up to 4 or 5 years of drug supply with individual doses are hermetically sealed. No need for refills. And while we were at it, we also added a bunch of bells and whistles, such as sensing and closed loops. So we're developing one of these for epilepsy, where there's a sensor that predicts the probability of a seizure and gives the drug prior to the seizure happening. So there's a lot of opportunity to put sensors. And of course, wireless communications is everywhere. So all our implantable devices that we're building are wirelessly enabled through a radio. The data goes on without any intervention from the patient, goes to the cloud, and reports are generated for the physician, the patient, and perhaps even the company, the manufacturer, during clinical trials. So this really allows for tight management of chronic disease patients. So here's a brief video that shows how the technology works. It's amazingly simple. You can see there's a belt of drug pellets that are individually sealed, and when needed, a drug pellet is pushed out through a catheter, and it is delivered at the site where it's needed. The microcatheter is withdrawn from the other catheter, and it moves on. So it's a very tiny device which can pack a lot of drug, and it's for the CNS disorders, we're implanting it in subcutaneously in the back of the head so that you don't have these catheters going past the neck if you implant them in the chest. So a few examples of things that we're pursuing. Alzheimer's, you know, there are some drugs that can actually slow down the progression of the disease. There's no cure for it. As such, but acetylcholinesterase inhibitors, if delivered centrally, can slow down the progression, and it increases efficacy because these have some really nasty side effects, cramps, muscle weakness, and so on, that limit its dosing. But given centrally, you can address that, and compliance is addressed, of course. Another thing I'm really excited about is depression for those patients who are refractory to other antidepressants. Monoamine oxidase inhibitors are really powerful antidepressants, but carry a black box warning. Patients who are on these can have some nasty side effects if they eat cheese or aged foods. It's the most effective therapy. It works for all those patients who are refractory to the other drugs. And so we're developing a system to develop to deliver this intracranially. Parkinson's disease, another debilitating condition. There are a couple of drugs. GDNF is in clinical trials right now. And apomorphine is an old drug. It's very potent. And if delivered centrally, it can be tolerated. MS interferons can be delivered. And one of the lowest hanging fruits, you know, one of the things I worry about in developing these things is regulatory process. And, you know, most of these will probably end up in Europe first. The reason we are going after oncology gliomas, it's a small market, but it that may be the best way to get FDA approval, because these patients have a short fuse and not very many options. So I think the good news is this technology is probably a couple of years away from going into humans. The bad news is with the FDA, the way it is, it's probably going to be 10 years before it's available in the U.S. We're really excited about it. You know, going from liquid drugs, you know, I worked on this several years, and it was staring at me, and it was so obvious to go to solid drug substance, seal the system, and it works really well. Thank you.
Let us define X. X is a solution. A solution to a seemingly insurmountable problem, like climate change or cancer, one that affects the world. But what if we redefine X as a challenge, an opportunity for radical thinking, a chance to light up the world with breakthrough ideas and cutting-edge technology, the stuff of science fiction that just might fly after all? Solving for X requires wonder and imagination and the vision to build seemingly impossible solutions to the world's biggest problems. Solve for X. Moonshot Thinking.